During my temporary absence in London on an important question of romance, he obtained admission to my house by means of the false pretense of being my brother. He then proceeded to win over the affections of my only ward when his own intentions, I'm utterly convinced, were purely financial. Tonight, if you dare. He subsequently stayed to tea and devoured every single muffin. And what makes his behaviour all the more heartless is that he was perfectly aware from the start that I have no brother, that I never had a brother, and that I don't intend to have a brother, not even of any kind.
Uncle Jack, please.
Oh, my word, Jack.
Come here, sweet child. How old are you, dear?
18, Aunt Augusta.
18? Well, it will not be long before you are of age and free from the restraints of your guardian.
According to the terms of her grandfather's will, she does not come legally of age until she is 35.
That does not seem to me to be a grave objection. 35 is a very attractive age. London society is full of women of the very highest birth who have, of their own free choice, remained 35 for years.
Algie, could you wait for me till I was 35?
Of course I could. You know I could.
Yes, I felt it instinctively. But I couldn't wait all that time.
And what is to be done, Cecily?
I don't know, Mr. Moncrieff.
My dear Mr. Worthing, as Miss Cardew states quite positively that she cannot wait until she is 35, a remark which I am bound to say seems to me to show a somewhat impatient nature, I would beg you to reconsider your decision.
No, my dear Lady Bracknell, the matter is entirely in your own hands. The moment you consent to my marriage with Gwendolyn, I will most gladly allow your nephew to form an alliance with my ward.
You must be aware that what you propose is out of the question.
And a passionate celibacy is all any of us can look forward to.